What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we got a special interview with you, for you guys today. Interviewing Coach Nick from B-Ball Breakdown. Coach Nick, how are you doing today, man?
I'm good. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, appreciate you being on with us.
Yeah, we really appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule to, you know, just sit down and talk NBA basketball with us today. But, Greg, I'm going to have you start off with some questions and everything that you want to ask Coach Nick.
Yeah. So obviously you're a coach, and like the two questions I have is like, what made you get into coaching? Like, why basketball? Why get into basketball and coach, you know, all these different levels of basketball players?
I think basketball, when I was growing up in my middle school, when I was, or even like in second, third grade, it was the only sport we had at our school. It's a very small school. So everybody kind of gravitated toward that. And then the fundamentals and the practice and all those kind of things always appealed to me, as far as I liked being in a gym by myself, even just working on skills. But especially when I was growing up, there wasn't enough information out there to help people like me improve better and quicker and more efficiently. And so I always felt like all the drills, all the camps, all the places and the practices I had, I always felt like there was got to be better ways to do what we're teaching, which, you know, in the 80s would have been what we had been taught in the 50s. Nothing had really changed for decades and decades. So it was exciting, and especially even now, like even midway through my coaching career, or the timeline, we've discovered so many more new fundamentals and proper ways of teaching, which finally align with what I've been looking for all these years. And that goes from how we teach shooting to just communication and motivation. And so now it's like we've gotten to some sort of the beginning of perhaps a golden age, where we're going to finally coach the way I had kind of needed and wanted when I was growing up, and would have been a lot better because of it.
Yeah, that's good. That's good to hear. And like the segmenting into my next question is like, what's one thing you tell the people that you train and the coach that you want to leave the mark on them? Like anything as far as shooting fundamentals, anything that's like unique to you as far as a coach?
Well, I mean, you know, yesterday when I was working with a bunch of, you know, 11 and 12 year olds, I think what I usually say when I start off with certain players is, or just new players, is the secret to basketball is lifting both feet in the air at the same time. And what that means is that could be like a skip dribble, it could be a gallop, it could be a hop into your shot, or it could be a split when on the catch and attack. It could also be the same kind of split when you're on defense to be able to explode into different directions. So that to me is what like speaks to me in a way that the kind of details you don't often get from a lot of other coaches, and that expands, like then you can kind of like, where else can I use these, that explosive move of literally both feet in the air for, you know, 2 inches off the ground, and then they explode into the ground and you can use ground reaction forces. That accounts for every sport, really, when you want to need to explode and change directions. So honestly, when we work on that kind of stuff, and then even balance, and then, you know, hip flexibility, core strength, because we don't need to be, you know, when I was growing up, we would want to get, you know, huge shoulders and these big arms and like all this weight. Maybe you'd skip leg day a few times because no one focused on that as much. So Dwight Howard, basically, when he came in the league, remember, he was Superman on top and like, you know, skinny guy on the bottom. And there's no doubt why, you know, he'd have back problems later on. That's what we all did, though. Now we know that the Kevin Durant kind of body is like the ideal body with a really strong core strength and flexibility. You don't need such gigantic muscles. So those are the other things too that we talk about as far as balance and explosion that will help you without even touching a basketball. You could become a much better basketball player without even touching the basketball, but just by just working on those things.
Yeah, you're right. And when I saw you break down that Damian Lillard video about his shot and why he's struggling, you talked about the core strength, so that was great insight. But Nicey, what questions do you have for him?
Well, Coach Nick, we obviously understand that, you know, you have a well understanding of the game of basketball and everything. I want to know, did you learn the game from your playing? Were you able to play at, you know, the junior high level, maybe even the high school level?
Yeah, thank you. I was actually like a D3 level player. I was going to go play D3 in Wisconsin at some school. But then I visited the University of Wisconsin in Madison, and I fell in love with the place. My mom had gone there. And so I went there. I actually even tried out, but it was kind of like a farce what they had. They had like four people show up, and it was whatever. So I was a manager for the team. And so that was a really great, learning experience. Having, I played on a really good high school team, so I did learn a lot from there. But it was a lot of the same things we talked about as far as what we had been teaching from the 40s through the 80s. Nothing had changed. I got another. It graduated to graduate level learning when I was Stu Jackson was the head coach there, and he was running the Rick Pitino method of running a D1 program. So that was a real big eye opener as well. How to expand and how to increase the knowledge of how to coach at that level. But again, it was still the same thing. I kind of call it like ground zero for this is 1994, like when I graduated college. There was a moment when all the coaching that we've been teaching from 1930 to 1994 kind of solidified, and anybody that age or older is going to simply stick to that. And it's really hard to get people my age or older to like understand, like there are a lot better ways to teach all these different things. And I get it. Tom Izzo showed me this must be the way to do it. And I'm like, well, okay, but we've learned so much in the last 15, 20 years. So anyway, to get back to my playing, so I was kind of like the coach on the floor. I was always the guy looking at it analytically and trying to figure out what strategies and talking to the coaches and really picking their brain when I played at high school. So I was always kind of that guy anyway, and it was just sort of a natural fit to kind of, morph into that. And primarily because any frustration I had as a player in terms of development and not developing as well as I wanted to motivated me to be a coach so I could give players the sentence that no one gave me that I didn't figure out, and it took me so much longer to figure out certain things when you could kind of get right to it a lot quicker and eliminate a lot of the heartache and effort that's needed to like get to a point where you're proficient. We can kind of speed that process up now.
Are some of those things what kind of inspired your start to open up a YouTube channel and start B-Ball Breakdown?
Probably not. I think I came at this more of an NBA analyst thing for the YouTube channel because I told this story before, but when the Celtics and the Bulls had an epic first round 7-game series in 2009, I think it was, Derrick Rose was, I think, maybe a rookie. Everyone was going crazy for it. It was amazing, but it was also a lot of really bad basketball being played, and no one was pointing out like the mistakes that were being made and why this wasn't really epic and amazing. These two teams going at it with their best. So that kind of motivated me to say, like, somebody should do a video that explains like what's going on defensively. Ray Allen averaged like 60 points a game in that series because of the way they were defending him off the pin downs. It was driving me nuts. And then of course they go play the Celtics like in the next round, and Ray Allen suddenly averages like 14 a game because the Magic I think that was Stan Van Gundy at the time coaching them, actually coached defense the right way. The names and the faces might be, it's been a long time, I forgot, but I think that was what happened. So anyway, the point being that like that's what the motivation was. I'd also been doing a lot of video editing. I had my own company doing like high-end video, event video stuff. So I had all this video editing experience. I had all this coaching experience up until that point. I had like performance experience too, having moved to LA to do stuff like that. So it was a kind of an interesting confluence of experiences that might've felt like up until that point in my life, I'd been like spinning my wheels and not quite getting a career going. All of a sudden it was like, wait, everything I had been doing the last, 10 or 15 years is perfect for what I need to do this channel.
Yeah, and I kind of want to switch over to, NBA basketball finally. I've seen you've made a ton of videos about the Lakers, Russell Westbrook specifically, and I have a very intriguing question about him later on. But, obviously Lakers have gotten off to a pretty slow start. They started off the year 7-6, no LeBron James for some of those games. Do you still feel like this is a ball club that is good enough to make it to the conference finals, let alone maybe reach an NBA finals at some point?
I always get burned by betting against LeBron. And I do it anyway, and I'm going to do it again now. Wow. So, no, I mean, there's no way. Listen, the Russell Westbrook experience is what everyone, like, and here's the thing. If you guys have followed me or anyone has, and it's funny because it's kind of bubbled up now because of the Lakers, but, I've been kind of pointing out his issues for a long time. And I've engendered a lot of hate because of that, because it's perceived that I'm hating on him. And I get it. Part of the reason is, you don't point out Steph Curry's mistakes and you point out all of Russell Westbrook's mistakes. Now, his mistakes are on a whole other level than any other guard in the league at his level. And he is a superstar. I'm not going to dispute the fact that he's a superstar. The guy averaged triple-double, but there is a huge skill deficit in his game. that is made up for by being an amazing athlete, which, you know, at some point will not be what he has anymore. And then we're going to, it'll be interesting to see what happens with him. So, but we're seeing, you know, over and over again, and it's just it's also the volume. I'll watch a game and it's like, okay, he makes this good play. But then there are so many other ones and you might not notice it. And I'll be like, well, you know, that's sort of my job. I feel like is I want to point out things that people don't notice. So you might not notice that like his rotation was so bad that the whole cascade of events caused that dunk on a defense. And, you know, so then it ends up me being a guy who's simply picking on Russell Westbrook for a variety of reasons. And to me, it's just because it's the high volume of mistakes that he makes. The joke I had on Twitter at some point was they wanted to stagger Russ's minutes with LeBron's minutes so Russ could have more time handling the ball more. And in my mind, that's not why they have to do it. They have to do it so that LeBron's on the bench and far away from Russ when he makes those mistakes and doesn't try and kill him on the floor. Because, you know, LeBron doesn't tolerate that kind of stuff, you know, usually. And I wonder what he's feeling.
I hate to interrupt you, Coach, but please. Do you feel like maximizing Russ in those circumstances is what LA needs right now? Because I actually feel like maximizing Russell Westbrook to a certain degree could be very detrimental to the Los Angeles Lakers overall.
Well, the argument would be to maximize Russ, you have to bench LeBron, right? Yeah. And that's a problem, you know, because Russ is best when he's got like, you know, at least three, if not four elite shooters around him to give him a lot of space. You're still going to see wild stuff. Like he had a good game in the box score the other day and they barely won over the Miami Heat.
Yeah.
And but like I'm like, okay, let's look at all the plays he made. I got to tell you, there were some turnovers that were so bad that I'm like, how can, you know, what is the point of scoring the 25 points if you're throwing the ball in the stands like that? There were some shots that were so bad. You know, and then he took the last shot at the end of regulation that was so bad, and you know he completely defied what Frank Vogel drew up in the huddle. So, that's what frustrates me. I can easily acknowledge that he does good stuff, but it's like, but then he just throws it all away with all he balances it out easily with the bad stuff. So how to make Russell Westbrook the best version of him, you know, is he has to play like shooting guard. He needs to attack on the catch from like the wing, like a traditional shooting guard.
Yeah.
Let LeBron set him up a little bit more. Like when he screens for LeBron and rolls, like that's good stuff. You know, you're going to have problems with him on defense though, because he loses his man and I had one of my tweets went viral the other day, because, you know, they were down by two, less than 20 seconds. So they had to foul, but instead Russ wanders up to near the ball, leaves his man on the basket for a dunk, and then ends the game.
Yeah.
That's not rare. It's not like you get hot or cold on defense. That, you know, it is what it is. So I just don't see how the Lakers, with this team, the way they're going to put it together, could get to the conference finals in a West that's really, really tough.
Yeah, and I agree with you. And when you're talking about the Miami Heat game, that third quarter, they didn't even play him. I thought Rondo looked very, very well with that second unit and managing everybody on the court. So that was something interesting to me. And when you brought up that Thunder point as well, there was no reason for him to come up and trap that at all. So, yeah, there's
Wait, do you think that that's what he was doing?
I think that's what he was doing. I think there was no reason to come off his man.
I heard trap in the background. I feel like somebody was yelling trap in the background. And, you know, Russ, he just does a bunch of crazy stuff that, you know, kind of makes you want to rip your hair out. Defensively as a coach.
Okay, so they wanted to trap for a couple seconds before maybe get a steal, and then they'd foul because there was enough time.
But it still made no sense given the side of this court that Russell Westbrook was on for him to go trap Shai Gilgeous-Alexander in the first place. So I still
right. It can't be him doing it. Yeah, it was weird. You know, and it was funny because there's another one where he turned the ball over. I think it was that game too, where he fires the ball off of Anthony Davis's head, who is like 3 feet in front of him.
Yeah, I saw that.
And but I actually had to defend Russ because everyone's like, what was he even trying to do? And I'm like, well, there was a guy cutting back door on that same side, and it looked like that he was trying to hit him. But he has a problem with visual perception. He doesn't always see what's like in front of him. It's a strange, you know, you get going so fast and everything is happening. He kind of goes blind in a way. Like he can't register, like, you know, so he'll throw passes like right to the defense. It's interesting. So the point being, like, everybody wants to put him at this like top three point guard in the league or whatever, top five player. And it's like, he's not that. And I think with this season, as it goes along, when the Laker fans, who are very loud and very influential, right? There are just so many of them across the landscape in the NBA. They're getting a taste for the first time of really getting what Russell Westbrook's like. And that's it. We'll have to see what's going to happen by the end of the season, what that perception is like. But I do know that, like, it's with people, more and more people over the couple of years have seen more and more of what I've been trying to point out from like 5 and 6 years ago. And I kind of stopped. I didn't even like really the last couple of years, although why someone's going to do a search for B-ball breakdown and Russ on Twitter. But like my feeling is that I really over the last like 2 years just kind of stopped because I was like, I don't want to deal with it anymore. You can see it for yourself or not, whatever. And of course, I pointed it out, you know, on that one turnover, that one whatever he did, of that one bad defense. And now everyone's like, you're constantly yelling at him. I'm like, dude, I haven't talked about him for like 2 years.
Yeah.
And here you are saying that. So anyway, it's an interesting thing. And as a result, it's a weird fit. Buddy Hield would have been infinitely better stretching the floor, hitting threes. He can actually handle the ball and pass too nicely. Buddy is probably would give you at least more like rational defense, just more like, you know, he'll get beat, but he'll be in position. He won't try and get out, you know, do too much stuff on the defensive end and probably be more solid. So that was the mistake. And you remember they had this big thing where that deal was about to be done. And then somebody freaked out and be like, it was like, no, get Russ instead. Right. There's probably an interesting story behind that too.
Yeah.
And so as a result, I think that might've been a big mistake by the Lakers.
Yeah. Don't you kind of feel like guys like, what's his name? Austin Reeves and Carmelo Anthony, even Malik Monk. Don't you feel like they kind of feel in that offensive role that Buddy Hield would have already, you know, kind of, you know, had to fill in?
Yeah, I guess.
Maybe defensively, it might look a little bit different. I'm not exactly sure, but.
Yeah. I mean, Austin Reeves, let's not beat around the bush. He's not going to get a minute of the playing time when, you know, THT comes back. Yeah. And Ariza comes back, whatever. I mean, he's simply there. I mean, you know, whatever. I've seen him make a couple nice plays, but he's not like a guy who should be getting minutes on a good team in the Western Conference. Sorry, Austin. Maybe, you know, at some point. But, you know, that's where they are depth-wise, too. It's like they're if they have to play him, they're not going to be better than 500 until they can get, you know, better players ahead of him.
I totally agree. So if it's not the Lakers, who's your team to come out the West right now?
Well, listen, there's no other way to say it. It's the Warriors.
Yeah,
the
Warriors, I totally agree.
As of today, the way they are playing, and here's what's funny. I'll toot my own horn for a second because I did a video a week and a half ago on how amazing their offense is. And at the time, they were ranked like 16th in offensive rating. And I had people yelling at me because to them, the number, like, and I was like, no, this is about process. This is about how they're moving the ball, how they're getting great shots. They might not be hitting them all right now, but no one is doing it like this and at this level so well, so early. Some people, I listen, Twitter is Twitter. Like they refused to understand what I was trying to tell them. I finally had to say like, you know, good luck. I can't help you anymore. But guess what happened over the last 10 days? They're now ranked like third, right?
Yeah.
It did swing to what, you know, you couldn't have held that back that long because they were getting such great shots. And by the way, there's somebody named Klay Thompson who's going to be coming back.
Exactly.
Who will probably be like 80% tops, but still, you know, you're talking about 80% Klay is still, it'll make them better. So I the way they're playing reminds me of like Portland from 1977 with the way they play defense, the way they play offense. I mean, their defense is better than their offense, honestly. So you have to say what we've seen over the first, you know, 15 games, whatever it's been, you have to pick the Warriors to be the people to get out of the West.
Yeah, and one thing I want to talk about Klay, and I talked about this to Nicely, is for me, him coming back, you said 80%. I'm worried about his mobility. You know, Achilles is hard to come back from with the movement, the lateral movement. How do you think he will be on the defensive end? I mean, I know he moves a lot off ball. He's used a lot in actions on the offensive end. How do you think that mobility will translate for the rest of the year?
Yeah, I mean, forward? I think part of it is just even like just feeling comfortable shooting.
Yeah.
So he might not be as quick in movement as far as movement goes, which means he might not be as open when he gets those catch and shoots. So he might not make as many. So he might end up being mortal. You know, he might shoot 34% from three. He might have trouble getting some of those off. So I would expect to see that at least in the very beginning. And then the Warriors' hope, obviously, is that will continue to progress. And that by April, after, you know, because they'd be foolish to bring him back before January. It'd be, you know, as far as the length. I think there's a connection between the longer Achilles, and remember he had the ACL before, the longer the Achilles people stay out, the better the prognosis is when they do come back. And so you don't want to rush that. But it would be an absolute miracle of the basketball gods if he came back anywhere beyond 80%. And that said, I would expect maybe it could be 50, and he could hit, you know, some threes, and he could be that presence, and he could maybe even be in a good position defensively. But I think defensively will also be a place where we can't forget, this guy was one of the best defenders in the league in the, on the perimeter.
That's my point. Yep.
I don't think he's going to be that. And I, you know, and that's tough, because if you're not like that level, you get to be below average really quick. But I don't know. I have faith and confidence. They're not going to throw him out there unless he's going to be adequate at least. And again, adequate for Klay Thompson will be a plus for them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of want to, you know, switch back over to the Lakers real quick. I remember watching one of your lives after, you know, I believe that the Lakers might have played the Warriors that night, actually. And at the towards the end of your live, you discussed, you know, how you felt like Russell Westbrook was the most unskilled superstar of all time. Oh, yeah. I just want you to kind of elaborate on that, because I thought that was really interesting.
Okay. I mean, I was, you know, I've been saying that more recently. Yes. Okay. So again, he's a superstar. And then, by the way, superstar has a lot of connotations, which in terms of like even like marketability, you know, and I love him on those commercials on the Mountain Dew stuff. I think those are hilarious. I love it. You know, that's why it's like debatable whether you can consider like Kawhi Leonard a superstar in my book, because he has done some commercials, not quite the same charisma, you know, in a way that like Michael Jordan, people who have that smile and they're not, and people, and they light up and they can sell products, right? Like that's part of it. I don't know how big of a part it is for superstar, but it's a part. Anyway, so, Russell Westbrook is a terrible three-point shooter. He does not have a floater. He doesn't finish, he finishes kind of average at the rim, believe it or not. And I've shown that over the course of a lot of years.
Very inefficient.
Yeah. You know, he has a pull-up, which is doesn't typically rank that high in terms of like the mid-range pull-ups, believe it or not. He likes to do it, but, you know, and certainly this year, it's not one of those things. So it's like, okay, scoring-wise, what is he? What does he really have? You know what I mean? Like, there's not a lot of going on there as far as the skill level. He's got overwhelming athletic ability. He can get right to the rim when he wants to. And then he'll, like, a lot of times, I mean, listen, in that game, he had the 28 points against Miami. Like, some of those shots he missed at the near the basket were like, this is no other superstar would miss that badly on those kind of shots. So he can make passes that are in front of him. And out of the high usage, he's going to get a lot of assists just because he handles the ball a lot. That's just sort of like a condition of being the ball in your hand. He doesn't throw like those great skip passes like you'll see LeBron, you know, who's on another level on that. So it's like, well, what skills does he really have? You know, when you want to use the checkbox of things, there's not a lot. You know, he can fill up the box score. I'm not going to dispute that. Those are facts. But you're talking about, you know, let's go through that you know, the checklist. He doesn't check a ton of those boxes. And so as a result, like, it's hard to say anything other than he's one of the, you know, he's sort of unskilled as a superstar. And by the way, of the other superstars, make that list. There's now a ton of them. Everybody else had a lot of those skills in my book. You know, I can't think of too many other guys who didn't, you know. And so as a result, like, here we are, and here the Lakers are.
Yeah, that's valid. That's valid. Did I see anything else?
So let's go ahead and switch over to and talk about, you know, some of these rookies and everybody. You know, I've been really impressed with guys like, you know, Jalen Green so far, Evan Mobley, even Scottie Barnes. What rookies have surprised you the most this season so far?
Well, you know, I just started watching Evan Mobley footage because everyone's going crazy about him. And I was going to do a video on how the Cavaliers had starting 3 7-footers. But then, of course, Markkanen, I just wanted to check actually what his he's quarantined. And so he's in another handful of games. It's too bad. So I'm going to have to do it anyway because everyone's talking about it. But Evan Mobley I've been looking at because I remember not being like that impressed with him coming out of USC. But, you know, he... offensively, he's raw, right? Like he's got a really high center of gravity, so he's not like slow, but it sort of takes him a little bit to get going. But he's got really good feet and good hands, and so all of a sudden he's kind of like slowly kind of get going, and then all of a sudden, boom, he gets the feet moving, and then he does have a little bit of quickness, but not the in starting quickness, if that makes sense. Then also he does exhibit a lot of energy on defense, and so he's very effective down there around the basket. His wingspan's got to be ridiculous. I don't know what it is, but it's got to be crazy. So he's impressive as far as what he's been able to do on the defensive end, more even, I guess, on the offensive end. Scottie Barnes, too, another guy who I went through some footage like a week or two ago, and a guy who's like, you know, these guys are all raw and they do need a lot of work. Jalen Green is another guy who I had done a little video before the season started saying, like, he's got like the step back three down off the dribble pretty well, but there's a lot of other holes in his game that I see. And it seems like that's bearing out. Like, it's just kind of, he's just inconsistent. He's sort of all over the place with this game right now. Again, totally normal for all these rookies, especially when you get a lot of usage for them. So who are the other rookies that I've seen? So Jalen Green, I'm like, Jalen Suggs looks like he's having a rough time with speed. So that's a thing. And that's what you usually look for with a lot of rookies is, can they handle the speed of the game? It could even be a thing with Gonzaga where with their schedule, they don't tend to play enough teams that really go fast. So they get to, you know, the pros and all of a sudden they're like, whoa, I can't handle this. And that looks like what he's dealing with right now. I still have hope that he's going to be really good and solid, but for right now, somebody sent me a whole montage of clips of him, and yeah, it doesn't look great right now. And it's the speed thing, really. He's just you know, behind. Who else can we talk about for rookies?
Cade Cunningham.
Okay, so Cade is the one guy who I had the highest on. I think he's the most polished. I need to dig in. So I'm not going to be the guy who's going to like pretend I'm like, while we're talking, I'm looking up some box score numbers. I'm like, he doesn't look like, I won't give you an opinion unless I really went and seen like 50 clips of him at least. So I haven't done that yet because it sounds like it's a SHIT show for the Pistons right now. And like they have him like in the corner. Like, so what I saw on Twitter was like, they have him like in the corner while Killian Hayes is running the show. And obviously Kate Cunningham to me is like a LeBron kind of guy, that he's got that size. He can handle the ball. He should be the guy. But you know, who knows what's going on with the coaching staff. Those guys are a little bit, what I've seen in the past from Casey is that, you know, those guys are the 1994 version of coaching.
Oh, yeah.
And there's not a lot of, you know, it's caveman style. And so it doesn't surprise me that, you know, a rookie isn't going to get a lot of extra run, or like they're not gonna get creative. Like Nick Nurse, for instance, who, you know, with Scottie Barnes, like they're out of the box, letting him make mistakes, letting him get his feet wet. And the way they play is obviously out of the box as well with all the zone stuff. So Scottie Barnes probably feels at home a little bit, almost like college, because they do a lot of interesting things defensively too. So so we'll see. I can't believe Cunningham will be anything but a really good player. But, you know, a lot of times it's fit and like where you are. Hopefully it doesn't happen to him.
Yeah, I agree. And then one more rookie I want to bring up is Quist Darte. Like I feel like a lot of people are not talking about him. What's your evaluation of his game?
Shit, I have not seen him either. And everyone's been clamoring to do a rookie review. So I got to put him. What are you seeing from him? Tell me what you see.
As a Pacer fan, I think I see a lot of Devin Booker in him. You know, he can create his own shot. He can come off screens. And I feel like how the Pacers are using him, especially with Caris LeVert out, he's kind of doing that Caris LeVert type of role, and where you can give him the ball and he can create his own shot. I haven't really watched him as much on the defensive end. It's hard to watch Pacers games. They're just stressful to watch, you know, with how they're coached. But I think on the offense end, I think he brings a lot of tools and he's going to be helpful. With the Pacers going forward.
Are you lighting Rick Carlisle on fire?
Yes. Just the way he's using Miles Turner, just stuff like that. It's hard to watch as a Pacers fan.
Yeah, I need to do a deep dive there, because I kind of felt like they get healthy and then they have a really good year, and then Carlisle gets all the credit, when in reality, Bjorkman just, you know, that team fell apart for a lot of reasons. But I have a feeling if they had not had so many injuries, you know, they would have won some more games, guys would have bought in better, and it wouldn't have been such a crazy story, whatever that story is going to be. That said, Nate McMillan got out of there in a hurry, and the story was simply because, you know, they wanted to modernize the offense. And McMillan was like, hell no, get me out of here. That's weird. Maybe McMillan knew something else, which is like what we're seeing now. I don't know, or what we saw with Bjorkman last year. So either way, it'll be interesting to see how that works. But Carlisle, you know, having had that situation in Dallas for a long time really, really helped him and helped his, you know, his standing among coaches. But, you know, we can't forget he didn't get into the playoffs or make past the first round for almost all those years after the title. So it's interesting.
Yeah. Nicely, what rookie are you enjoying watching right now?
Davion Mitchell. Oh, I'm sorry. Nicely. I thought you asked me. Go ahead.
Oh, no, my bad.
Yeah.
I mean, me specifically, I've kind of, you know, done a little bit of digging on some Cade Cunningham, just, you know, kind of slowly trying to analyze how Detroit's trying to bring him on and everything. But I feel like the rookie that's kind of impressed me the most are Evan Mobley and Scottie Barnes. I mean, first and foremost, with Scottie Barnes, I was not too surprised that Toronto took him, because heading into, you know, the draft, I was hearing that, you know, Toronto was starting to get really, really more high and higher on that guy as, you know, the workouts, you know, just progressed. And then when it comes to Jalen Suggs, I felt like, in a way, I just feel like, you know, he might be a taller, slightly better version of Fred VanVleet. I mean, you're talking about a guy that has a few offensive capabilities and everything, can pass the ball to a certain degree. But what scared me about Suggs is he doesn't do anything great. He does a lot of things good. Defensively, gives a lot of effort, but there's not one thing that he does great. And I just felt like Scottie Barnes, when I look at his intangibles, when I look at what he brings to the table, I feel like that was a guy that, you know, just screams Toronto basketball. And then on top of that, he kind of seemed like he was going to be insurance just in case Pascal Siakam ended up leaving town. So I've been, you know, a big Scottie Barnes proponent since, you know, the beginning of the draft.
Nice. It's a nice story with the Raptors, who, like, you know, I don't think anybody thought they'd be really, really good, but they're actually kind of coming back into their own and might be tough because of that. And Siakam coming back, sort of. Jalen Suggs to me, by the way, I think kind of reminded me of Jason Kidd, at least in college. Body type and movement quality. Obviously, you know, and Kidd played, did he play only 2 years at Cal? Wow, that's a good question. Suggs played 4 years, right? Is he a 4 year player at Gonzaga?
Suggs is a 1 year player.
Suggs he's one and done. Wow, yeah. He seems older. Gosh, forgive me. You're right. So Kidd came into the league more polished because he played, I think, at least another year, if not more. He might have been at Cal, but he reminds me of him a little bit as far as he's on balance. He's under control. He like controls the game, but yeah, not yet. But I can't wait to check some of these other guys out, because there's a lot of guys that are getting opportunities now. And, you know, there's always good surprises there.
You mentioned Davion Mitchell. I want to get to him real quick. What I'm seeing on the defensive end, I'm telling nicely, like, he was really like that on the defensive end. I watched the Jazz game when they played the Jazz, and how he shut down Donovan Mitchell. It was incredible to me. I don't know if you watched that game, but what are you seeing for Davion Mitchell early on?
Well, I mean, I think him and Lou Dort are going to have this like great rivalry. Who's better at, you know, shutting down perimeter defenders? Because they're both bulldogs like that, right? They just get after it and they're in your face, and they're really strong and they're quick, and they have, you know, you don't want to guard them. Like I can picture guys catching the ball and like sort of squaring up and seeing them in the stance in front of them with smoke coming out of their ears and like just passing the ball, you know, not even wanting to, I don't want to deal with that. So absolutely. And you know, Davion Mitchell, it has all the other abilities on offense too. So I think he's going to be a terrific player in this league. I got to watch more. It's kind of hard. The Kings, even though I'm on the West Coast, the Kings have sort of drifted by my focus for whatever reason recently. And they started out well, and then Harrison Barnes was doing really well, because, you know, I had this whole Harrison Barnes thing after his rookie year, where I was like, this. There's a tweet, I refuse to delete it, but there's a tweet out there that says, you know, if not now, at some point soon, Harrison Barnes will be the best player on this Warriors team. This is like way before Steph became Steph, even. This is like maybe 2013. But for those reasons that I saw then, like, he was scoring 25 a game and really looking like he was coming into his own. I think he's cooled down a little bit since then too. But either way, to get back to Davion Mitchell, just a great player to watch. Really fun from a coach's perspective, because he tries so hard, and he really is effective defensively. Because remember, there's things like, you can try really hard, but it could be like fake hustle, or it could just be like misdirected energy. This guy has it, and he does it. He knows how to use it and knows how to shut guys down. So it's great to watch.
Yeah, it is.
Has there been a player in this rookie class that you came in that you weren't too necessarily high on, but, you know, has kind of surprised you and kind of, you know, made you kind of eat your words so far this season?
Oh, well, Jalen Green is going to be, would be that guy if he starts playing a little bit better. But he seems like what I predicted, sort of like, you know, but I mean, that's also the state of the Rockets, right? They're just sort of, they don't have any incentive to win. It almost feels like the Rockets, well, they want to put on a good show and like make it really competitive. But then, you know, by the stretch, if it's close to them having a chance to win, they don't want to win those games. But so he's the guy if he starts doing even better than what he does now, which I think is sort of, you know, inconsistent. Then that would be the guy. Other than that, like, Josh Giddey is another guy who people are really high on, and I went through and I'm like, yeah, he's not there yet either. There's some good highlights, but there's some issues too that he needs to get better at. So that's one guy. Now, Franz Wagner.
Do you want to elaborate on some of those things?
Yeah, elaborate on Josh Giddey. Yeah.
You know, like, everyone says passing. It's like, yeah, I see some. He does have really good vision and the willingness to pass, but a lot of them are ill-advised and they get deflected. Ball handling too is, to me, needs to be improved. And then, you know, but he's not intimidated, which is a good thing. I like to watch rookies and see, do they behave like if they're intimidated by the situation or not? And he seems like he's like, no, nothing's going to faze him. His shooting is a problem, and it starts to make me wonder what's going on in Australia, because except for Patty Mills, who I was talking about something this with somebody else. Patty Mills, I don't think came up through the typical Australian program because he's an Aborigine. I think he came up maybe on his own. I got to look into more before I talk out of turn, but the reason why he shoots really well is an anomaly compared to all the other Aussies that are coming in to the NBA. And it makes me wonder, like, what are they teaching? Because Giddy, for instance, doesn't really dip on his shot. And that's a real problem when you want to shoot threes. So that's the source of your power. And, you know, even a guy like Ingles, who does shoot well percentage-wise, his shot is so ugly. And like, you know, it to me was like, that's how he had to get to, because of the teaching as an early age in Australia made him kind of do that, to find some way to make these shots. But nonetheless, you're talking about, you know, guys like, who on the Sixers. Ben Simmons is one, Simmons. But then it's Thibault. But apparently, then I just realized that Thibault apparently didn't really grow up in Australia, so maybe we can't count him. Either way, I'm worried about that. And so Giddy's another one of those guys. He doesn't really have good rhythm on a shot, and so as a result, like, I feel like he's going to really struggle to shoot threes. But he's fun, and he does, you know, throw crazy passes and really sees the floor. So that could develop into something really interesting too. By the way, the OKC could develop into something really interesting at some point with Shai Gilgeous and him and the other players they have. But they're fun, and they are tough. And Lu Dort is another guy. If they could figure some things out, they could be really kind of competitive. But again, they have no incentive to be competitive this year. So you don't look for them to win too many games. But, you know, the Lakers certainly have run into that buzzsaw a couple times now, and it's been exciting.
What are some things that you kind of look for in some of these rookie prospects heading into, you know, their first year?
Well, so the thing about being intimidated is a big one. You know, like Jimmy Butler caught my eye as a rookie because this guy was not going to back down to anybody. And you could see it, you know, and that told me, like, this guy is here to play. You know, but we're talking about rookies. I look at, you know, shot mechanics, which tend to improve. Three-point percentage is maybe the one thing you can kind of predict across the board in a general sense for NBA players. It does seem to tick up over the course of a career if you play, you know, regular minutes over 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years. There is some notion that three-point percentage goes up. Now, why is that? If you're struggling when you first start, perhaps it's because the way they teach shooting still, the lower levels in the college is bad, and it is a lot of the time. I have people crying on my shoulder because of what they were forced to do, that it's like the Stone Age. So the farther they get away from that, the better they can actually shoot. So that's one thing. So I look at mechanics for sure. I do look at decision-making, like how are they doing when they drive? Can they make a skip pass to the corners? Can they do that kind of stuff? Let's see, how do they finish at the basket? Do they have those kind of skills? You know, like Donovan Mitchell was a good one. I did a video on him actually, looking through his footage, and I did a presentation on him about Louisville versus the pros. And like, you could see, like, he'd have the move to get by the guy, but he wouldn't necessarily finish that well at Louisville. But you would know that once he got to work with NBA trainers who are, for, you know, for a lot of them are really good, that would improve and he'd be a better player. So that's how he goes from being like a 14 point a game scorer in Louisville to like over 20 in the pros overnight. So you look at like finishing skills, you look at that kind of stuff. Can they get by their guy or not? That's another big one too. It's like, are you sitting there just pounding the ball in place and like doing all the stuff, but you can't get by anybody? You know, so those are the big ones. You know, defensively it's tough because I feel like it's just like whatever they can do to hold on at that point in their first year. Although then you get a guy like Davion Mitchell who is just already way light years ahead.
Yeah. What surprises have you seen? What has surprised teams or maybe players that you're seeing so far this season?
Well, so the Wizards, I'm kicking myself because I was going to do a video on them before the season started. And I might have talked to somebody on the team who didn't share my enthusiasm. And so I said, well, maybe they know something I don't know, and I didn't do it. And I'm really mad because I would have loved to have been way ahead, and I was. Like, I might have a text I could show you. Like, I was saying, because again, the players they got for Russ were good, much better than they had the year before, and even more importantly, a much better fit around Bradley Beal.
Yeah.
And so here we're seeing it. Beal is the centerpiece of their offense. It works really well. We knew that Kuzma is really good. We knew that KCP is really solid. Montrezl Harrell was a reigning sixth man of the year. And we got to find out what happened to get him so in the doghouse that they needed to like get him out of there as quickly as they can by simply not playing it. Because you have to remember, he had a player option, and the Lakers clearly didn't want him. So, and I said this before, but it's like, if you're the management and he has a player option, you're like, whoa, we got to figure out a way for him not to exercise that. Well, what can we do to make sure he doesn't want to stay here anymore? Well, it would be not playing him at all in the playoffs and not telling him why. That would do it. And they, it would end up being a trade, but I wonder if they had to get him signed and then trade him. I can't remember that, because that was part of it. And I'm sure he was like, please get me out of this, far away from here as possible. So either way, you have a guy who can score 20 and get 10 rebounds every given night off the bench. That's fantastic for you. So they're good. They really are good. And you know, can they keep it up? And is the schedule being nice to them? Maybe a little bit, but you can't overlook a, I want to say it's 9-3 now, whatever.
Yeah,
it is.
Nine
it's
and like,
You don't win 9 of 12 games in the NBA without being solid, no matter who you're playing.
Exactly.
12 games is not trivial. You know, it's what? It's 12 out of 82. That's 10% of your season. I don't know, whatever we are. That's a lot.
Yeah.
That's worth winning. So without question, the Wizards are the ones who are really, I'm on 12 divided by 82. I'm kind of curious. That is four. It's almost 15% of your season. That's a big chunk.
Yeah, that is. And I think they're sneaky good. I think the Beal and Dinwiddie, I like the combination of them and how they can score off each other. And then how Kuzma is really stretching the floor. I mean, tell nicely that Kuzma's good. I've been telling him that for a minute. Like, I like Kuzma.
I don't like the inconsistency. I really don't.
Yeah, well, maybe, you know, with he gets more minutes and away from, you know, it's hard to be consistent when you play alongside LeBron.
Yeah,
because you never know, you don't get the ball a lot. It's not a lot of flow. And by the way, forgive me for not mentioning Spencer Dinwiddie first, because absolutely that was a big key. He's a friend of the Breakdown. And forgive me for not saying that, yes, he elevates them too.
Yeah.
That's huge for them. And he knows, you know, like Brad and him, like they'll work out together. So their games are already patterned nicely for each other without question. So again, yes, they are good. And the fresh coaching, it's all those things are really important.
Have there been any teams so far this season that you feel like are kind of going under the radar right now that could potentially go into the postseason this year and have maybe a Atlanta Hawks type of run?
Ooh, that's a good question. Let me look at the standings for 1 second and see if I can figure that out. You know, I kind of have felt like the Bulls were on that trajectory. And now, who would have known that Vucevic is like the guy that like harshes their vibe so much? Because he goes out, they look terrible. So the Bulls made me kind of feel that way. The Knicks are showing that, like, I think it was, I was liking the Knicks a little bit. I thought they shored up some things that they needed to, but they're not, they're just, you know, like probably slightly better maybe than they were last year. So any of the underdog teams, gosh, I don't see anybody like in the East. The Hawks are a conundrum in themselves because they should be so much better than they are. But let's see, maybe in the West, is there anybody? I would have thought that Memphis with Jaren Jackson coming back for the full season would have really been really tough, and they're still bumbling around and struggling too. And that's worthy of figuring out what's going on there, because they have some nice pieces. The Nuggets were probably going to be thought to not be so good with Jamal Murray being out, I think, for most of the year. But lo and behold, they're surprising me for sure, being, you know, up in the upper part of the Western Conference as of today. So, you know, again, is Jokic that guy that you want to count out and think he's not going to be able to do it, and then he does? Maybe it's the Nuggets. Maybe Jokic can do it, and we're all overlooking that.
Jokic is playing very well right now.
Yeah. And we know this. We've seen him. He's done it. And yet you still kind of felt like, well, no Jamal, then, you know, let's write them off. And Michael Porter Jr.'s back is an issue. I'd be really worried about that. Really worried.
Well, Greg, I mean, is there any final questions you'd like to ask Coach Nick before we let him get up out of here?
No, there's no questions. Thank you for your time, man, for sure. It was great hearing your insight about, you know, all these basketball teams and what you do.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you for letting me talk so much. I think I went on for a little while. But, hey, a good Sunday morning to talk on the NBA is always great with me.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate you, Coach Nick, for stopping by the Ball Fake Podcast. Thank you guys so much for tuning in to another episode with us on the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're new to our YouTube channel or you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice little review. But besides that, it's your boy, Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host, Greg King. And we out.
We out.